without ice, we were destined to fall, even in the brightest days.
All right, you guys got about 10 seconds, 10 seconds. Three, two, one. Hey, welcome to Youth Group. I am so glad that you are here. Hey, listen, my name is Kevin, and we believe that youth groups should be fun around here. We don't believe in a boring youth group. That's no fun. So I want to play a game tonight. Do I have anybody that would play a game with me? Before I ask you about playing this game, I need to explain a couple of things to you. I don't know about you guys, but over the last few years, they've gone to this thing called hands-free driving. Hands-free driving, that means that I cannot be on my cell phone. You should have a Bluetooth device. Your phone should be connected to your phone or to your car, or you should have like an earpiece or something like that. And so I thought about it. I said, hey, what else can we do that is hands-free? I see some hands in the air that want to play my game. I need three people. Let me see. Let's go with Harley because she hasn't played in a while. Andrea, I'm going to have you play, but there's a caveat. Cassandra, Cupcake, yes or no? Oh, dang it. I got you, though. I got you on the next one. Okay, give me these two right here. Yeah, you two, Emmy and Nick. Come up here. So here's the way that we're going to play the game. We're going to have a cupcake challenge. There's a cupcake challenge. And here's all I need you to do. I need you to eat this cupcake in less than a minute. And that is all that you have to do. Oh wait. I'm not done explaining the rules. Here's the thing. You have to eat this cupcake hands-free. Hands-free. And that means that you have to eat it without touching the cupcake. And yes, the wrapper will remain on. Whoever eats the most cupcake in less than a minute.
So what you're saying is that I could eat that wrapper too, so I could just devour the
cupcake. It is not an edible wrapper, but if you eat it, we have a nurse in the building. Hey, can we give it up for Maggie just got pinned yesterday, y'all. So we do have a nurse in the building. So if something should happen, Pastor Nick, is there a disclaimer that I need to tell them or anything for insurance purposes? No? We're good? All right. All right, so here's the deal. Whoever eats the most cupcake in less than a minute, you get a candy bar. You ready? In three. Hold on. What are you guys doing? Who's licking? I saw somebody lick their. Did they lick the cup? Oh, okay. Are you guys ready? You got to start in the upright position. Okay. All right, you can be bent over. Ready? In three, two. Well, hold on. Are you guys like really, really hungry or?
Oh my God.
Did you have dinner?
Go.
Okay, hold on. Ready? Here we go. In three, two. Harley, does it smell good?
Does it?
No? Oh, okay. In three, two, one, go. Oh, baby. They are really. Emerson is starving. She is eating the foil wrapper and everything. I'm pretty sure that she has. Is Emerson, that cupcake is in your nachos. Oh my gosh. This is so strange. Nicholas said, forget this. No more Mr. Nice Guy. I'm going to eat all of this cupcake. Where is the timer? There is no timer. All right. Nick, did you eat it all, Nick? All right. 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Stop. Stop. Oh. Okay. I just have one question for you guys. Do your parents feed you? I mean, my God. Look at this. Well, hold on. Hold on. Stop. Open your mouth. Ah, I did not want seafood tonight. Let me see. Oh, he just swallowed his cupcake. But you have cupcake. Ooh. So, I don't know, you guys. I don't know. Harley? Yeah. Nick? Yeah. How about Emerson? Yeah. All right. Well, I'm going to say that Harley is the winner tonight. I just want you guys, just wait, just look. Y'all see this? Look at her face, though. How did she get all of that cupcake with none of it on her? Harley, that's impressive. All right, you guys go have a seat. Can I get a couple of leaders to come and take this table away? Hey, I'm so excited that you guys are here tonight. Tonight, yeah, absolutely. Go grab a napkin from the back. Tonight we have a guest speaker all the way from the beautiful country of Brainerd. We have David Johansen here with us tonight. He's a missionary to the Arab world, and he's going to come and share with you guys tonight. But before we do that, I just have a couple of announcements. First announcement is this. If you want to serve in any area, simply fill out a connection card. We would love to have you students serving all over the church, not just in the kids' areas, but as ushers, as greeters in the cafe, at the welcome desk, as a door greeter with Merv, you can help open the door with him. I'm sure he would love the company. But there are so many areas you can serve on the worship team. Like, there are so many areas that you guys can serve, and we want to empower you to do that. So if you're interested in serving in any capacity, simply fill out a connection card, drop it in the drop box, and then we'll get you hooked up. Secondly, we have camp coming up. The camp slide should be right there. We're going July the 18th to the 22nd. If you need more information, there's a camp flyer right at the welcome desk.
Welcome desk.
Yes, it's the welcome desk. Y'all get on back there, you hear? All right. It's a text is coming out of me. But the welcome desk has the flyer. It also has our group code so that you can register. If you need a scholarship, you need to let me know now. If you need any kind of assistance so that we can get you signed up and registered through the district. That goes for all of you that are watching online as well. If you want to go to camp, I'm aware that you're not here tonight, but if you want to go to camp, if you want to join with the hundreds, if not thousands of other students that will be at camp this year, we want you to be a part of that. All right. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to go into a time of worship. Why don't you guys stand to your feet and come on up front. Father, we are so grateful for who you are. God, we're thankful for this evening, and we ask that you would just be with us. God, we also pray against any inclement weather that would have any ill effects on homes or travel or anything like that. God, we ask for your protection. We ask for your just that you would come around our city, around our state, Lord, and that you would protect not only us here in this building, but all the people that are at home right now, all of those that are in the path of the storms that are brewing. God, we know that you are mighty. We know that you are great. So have your way in this place. We love you, and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
As I reflect, I find perspective. They're in the best and worst days of this life. You're always on my side.
Yeah, can you put your hands together?
You're in the pain, you're in the promise. And on the days the furnace finds my faith, you're the one within the flames.
Let me hear you.
I don't need to know what the future says, 'cause if the past could talk, it would tell me this, that my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I'll trust him with what comes next. For the God I know is known for faithfulness. Oh, oh. Yeah, my hindsight says I can trust him with what's next. Yeah, my God I know is known for There's more ahead than what's behind me. Cause through the highs and lows and in between, God, you go ahead of me. And where you call me, I will follow. If the water falls beneath my feet, you'll call me from the deep. I don't need to know what the future says, cause if the past could talk, it would tell me this, that my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I'll trust him with what comes next. Oh, the God I know is known for faithfulness. Oh, oh. Yeah, my hindsight says I can trust him with what's next. For the God I know is known for faithfulness. Sing, oh.
Came ready to worship tonight, didn't you? Let me hear you.
Then my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I'll trust him with what comes next. Cause my hindsight says I can count on this. Then my God isn't finished yet. If he did it before, he can do it again. So I'll trust him with what comes next. For the God I know is known for faithfulness. Yeah, my hindsight says I can trust him with what's next. Yeah, the God I know is known for faithfulness.
Come on, lift a shout of praise. God, we love you. We worship you tonight. Jesus, we're here for you and for you alone. Let's sing.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you. There is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring.
Worthy of every breath.
Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. We live for you.
Jesus, the name above.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
God, we want to see you more clearly tonight. We want to understand just how big you are, how powerful you are, how loving you are. God, you are the firm foundation of our lives. Everything that we need is in you. So let's sing, I will build my life.
I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will put my life upon your love. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes.
God, tonight I pray that that would be true over every one of us here. God, that we would build our life upon you. God, that everything about us would be supported and sustained by you. God, that we would give you everything, Lord. God, that's our prayer tonight. That's our heart's desire. God, I pray you would speak to us, challenge us through our missionary speaking here tonight. God, I pray that you would make us more like Jesus tonight. Thank you, God. We worship you. in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
You guys can head back to your seats as you are already doing. Hey, I had the opportunity to actually get to meet not only on the phone here, but at the Equip Conference, our missionary David. And it's a funny story. I was the last person in the building one day a couple of weeks ago, and the phone rings, and I just happened to be in the office, and I answer. I'm like, hello? Who's this? And he says, this is missionary David Johansen. I was wondering if you're pastors. And I'm like, well, I'm a pastor. How can I help? And we just struck up a conversation. And, you know, the Lord just said, hey, you should have David come out and speak. So I asked Pastor Nick if he would allow us to have a missionary come and speak to our youth group. So would you guys do me a favor and give him a warm reach welcome as he comes and shares a message with us? Go ahead. Give him. Yeah, there you go. There you go. They're like, okay, I don't know. All right, David, thank you.
Good evening. Yeah, pas vu que ça maintenant, yeah? Non? No, Scandinavians here in Minnesota, you know, yeah. It is good to be here. I appreciate the opportunity to come and speak to you. I am very excited because God spoke to me when I was your age, or maybe even a little younger. And I want to just share a little bit this evening about what we do in missions overseas, but also show you a slideshow and give you a face of what is there in the country we serve in Lebanon. I was raised in a Christian home here in Minnesota, but I could not get to heaven because of my parents. I had to accept Jesus into my own heart and then follow him. And it was at a church meeting like this that God called me into missions when I was 9 years old. And I know that God speaks to young and old alike, and he can speak to you. So this evening, I want to touch a little bit about God's voice. I want you to hear it and then proclaim it. Proclaim what you hear. God wants you to be salt and light to this world, and it's important that you hear God's call. My wife is not here, unfortunately. She is helping babysit some of our grandchildren. We have four kids, two boys, two girls, and we have 9 grandchildren. Yeah, that means I'm old, okay? but God has still got a fire inside this tank, and we want to still work for him. And we are excited that we can continue this ministry as he allows us to. My wife has a special testimony because I married outside of the clan. Okay, I did not marry a Minnesotan. God called me. I went to Bible school. You know what I'm talking about, okay? And I went to the field single. This is a miracle in and of itself. I went single. But they placed me next to a veteran missionary so that I would be, you know, supervised and have someone around me and so forth. Well, this missionary, his sister came to visit, and the Spirit of the Lord moved in my heart. My flesh did too, and you know what I'm talking about, right? You know, you're kind of like, woo, yeah, thank you, Jesus. It was... Now, I had to travel. I was in Africa at the time, so I met my wife in Africa. But she has a unique testimony because she comes. She's the very product of missions. What you guys have done and prayed for and giving and Speed the Light and other things, and thank you for that because it has helped us on the field immensely. My wife grew up in a Shiite Muslim home in West Africa. Her parents migrated from Lebanon years, decades ago, and she was born and raised in Africa and in a Muslim setting. And because a missionary was sent out from here, like a church like this, people prayed and gave it an offering and sent a missionary out. It reached out to this family, and there are 11 children in this family. Good-sized family, huh? And the oldest, the firstborn, was invited to come to church, witness to, and he went to church. Why? Because he wanted to find a girl to date. He wanted to find a young lady there in church. Well, God had other plans and got a hold of his heart, and he accepted the Lord. Long story short, he had to flee for his life. Parents didn't exactly like what happened, the change in his life. But today, God has done a work in this family. And out of the 11 children, 5 have come to know Jesus as the Lord and Savior. 2 have become ministers of the gospel. And God has also touched my father-in-law. And at age 85, he accepted Jesus into his heart. Never give up on people. Don't write people off, young or old. God's Spirit can move and change their heart. I have a prayer card. This is an old picture. It's even on the board there. This church supports us. But you can see my lovely wife here, and I thank the Lord for her. So she's the product of missions. And this is very important that God speaks. God spoke to her heart through the lives of others, and that they shared the love of Jesus with her when she came to the States. Now, real quick thing. In that culture, she does not make a decision on her own. She had to listen to her parents, her uncles, her aunts. The family got together and made a group decision as a whole. How would you like that? You know, here in the States, we emphasize you get to be 18, then you get to make your own decisions. You're an adult, a legal adult. You can do that. You know, but she didn't have a choice. They made decisions for her. But her brothers had been praying and allowed her to come to the States to get an education. She wasn't yet a believer. They took her in and brought her to church the first Sunday she was here in the States. And she couldn't, just was overwhelmed by what was she was seeing. But it was the love of others that they were sharing with her, the love of Jesus. And she eventually took a couple of years. God softened her heart and she accepted the Lord. So we got married. We've been married 35 years. And God has been faithful over those years to us. We thank God for that. And he will provide for you. Just as a little side thought, yeah, I went to Africa single. God provides. Don't worry about your future, as we even sang tonight. We got a firm foundation. God goes before us. He prepares the way. He's got your life all planned. We plan our way, but the Lord directs our steps. And he's going to do that for you. And he's brought us. We are in church planning, evangelism, discipleship, teaching, preaching. We do this. We start churches. I pastor churches. We witness to others, mainly in our area of the Arab world, Muslims. We worked, I've been 37 years in missions, 16 of those in French-speaking West Africa, worked around the continent. Then we transferred to the Middle East and began learning Arabic and to reach out. And my wife, although of Lebanese descent, never lived in Lebanon till we went there to go work. So we have now been, we've lived in Jordan, we've lived in Syria, and we've been now 17 plus years in Lebanon, been to other countries in Iraq and war areas and zones and North African countries. But God is faithful, and he is building his church. And thankfully, you have had a part in that. I want to show you a video of Lebanon, because often we think of Muslims in the Middle East as terrorists, Muslims, you know, die by the sword, you know, or convert. But I want you to see this video of people, and then I'm going to come back and share a little bit. If that video will go. All right.
Say who go
They're not all carrying AK-47s, are they? I mean, you know, we have this stereotype. We think of the Muslim world or Arabs as being a bunch of terrorists. But I want you to know that they are not like all like that. They have to live lives like we do, eat, drink, go to work, have their kids go to school, and so forth. And they're not our enemy. Muslims are not our enemy. Your neighbor, your classmates are not your enemy. Satan is our enemy. And we need to remember that they've been created in the image of God. We just want to bring them the words of life. Let them come to know who Jesus is. And that only happens when we listen to God. We hear God's voice. He speaks to us. And then we proclaim what he tells us to do. God speaks to all of us, all ages, young and old. When I was 9, I didn't fully understand the call of God in my life. But there were people that nurtured it, that brought it along. And you grow and things come along. And I know in our society today, if our internet page doesn't load fast enough, we get a little ticked off. But God does a work, and it takes time to do that. And I can testify after all these decades of years, but we need people to go. Because one day I'm going to retire. You guys need to step up. You're going to take that torch and carry it farther than I ever done. And you're going to shine brighter in different areas and with the light of the gospel and the love of Jesus. So I would encourage you to do that. But how do you listen? How do you hear the voice of the Lord? How do you sense his direction in your life? I would just encourage you to, as you've already done, worship the Lord, read his word, pray, meet with your pastor. Let that be cultivated in your heart and life. And I think of the story in the Old Testament of Samuel. He was a young boy, brought into the temple, was at the temple, and God spoke to him. He didn't fully understand it, and he went to see the high priest, Eli, and finally he realizes that God's trying to speak to him, and he said, just when you hear your voice called again, just say, "Hear my Lord, speak." And so let God speak to you. I know he can do that. He will do that and does that with you. But the main emphasis, I want to bring a story of David in the Old Testament and relate what we do in the Middle East as well. Lebanon is going through difficulties. They've got political hardships. We have electricity 2 hours a day. We have to subscribe to a generator to have electricity or have solar panels or something to have electricity. And the money has been devaluated. Unemployment's over 50%. Hardships all around. Not to mention, you know, COVID and all that that had happened. But so it's a challenging area. But what do we do? How do we work? We reach out. We want to do what God wants us to do. We hear his voice and then proclaim what he's doing or what he wants us to say to others. So I'd encourage you to hear, listen to what God wants you to do. Some of you I know are going to, one's going to Trinity. I think it's Isaiah, right? God is leading and guiding your steps little by little. But I want you to hear God's voice, what he wants you to do, even at this young age. So David was a young man. He's the last of a number of sons. And Samuel, who had heard God's voice in that temple, learned to proclaim the word of the Lord. He came and he anointed. He was going to anoint a new. Saul was rejected, and David was going to be anointed by Samuel. Now, all the sons came forward, and he saw the first son. Samuel thought, "This is the one. This is the man. He's big. He's, you know, he's got muscles, and he stands head and shoulders above everybody. This dude is going to be the next king." God says, "No. Not him." And maybe you've been looked at or by others and they think, well, you could do this or you can do that, but you want to do what God wants you to do. And God told Samuel, do not look at his appearance at the height of his him, or because I've rejected him. For God sees not as a man sees, for man looks at the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. God sees your heart. He knows what you're thinking. Your outside is important. Yeah, we want to look nice and do things, but God sees the heart. And so Samuel, after having a number of sons go by, 6, 7 sons go by, and he says, "Isn't there another one?" "Yeah, there's one more. He's out tending the sheep. You know, he's a farmer there. He's out there watching his little animals." Yeah. And you think, well, he can't do anything. He's just a little kid. But he calls him in, and that was the one that God had called. He was anointed to serve. And I believe God wants to anoint you to serve. He wants you to be that salt and light. And he wants to put his hand upon your life. But you got to hear that call. You got to hear his voice in your own life. There may not always be a Samuel coming next to you and proclaiming that word over you or anointing you with oil, but God can do that by his. How does God speak to us? God speaks to us 3 different ways. He speaks to us through his word. We read his word, and we can hear of things like the Great Commission in Matthew 28:19. Go into all the world. Make disciples of all nations. This is a common missions thing. We know that. It's in his word. We're told to be a witness. So we have his word. But he speaks to us individually by his spirit. God speaks to you. He speaks to every one of us by his spirit. And then thirdly, he speaks to us through the body of Christ. Others will identify and sense and confirm that call. They'll nurture you. Your pastor here will see that and help that in your life and counsel and pray and guide you along the way. So he speaks to us in these ways. And God isn't necessarily interested in your ability or inability. If you can eat a cupcake in under a minute without getting your face dirty, kudos to you. That's great. Congratulations. But God isn't real concerned about your ability or inability, but God is concerned about your availability. He wants you to say, "Hear my Lord, use me." I don't know how some of you have played sports, you had recess or do something picked, and you're the last one to get picked for whatever, playing some game. You're like, "Yeah, well, they don't want me. I don't think I'm very good." God doesn't care. If you just say yes to him, he'll use you. He will give you wisdom, power, anointing, his spirit. He will let your light shine brightly, if you will just say, here am I, Lord, use me. And you can do that. When I was in school, not everybody's a believer and not are open, but even growing up, knowing I had been called of God, I would witness to others. I did things like in speech class and school, I spoke on heaven and hell. Yeah, well, that'll create a conversation in class today, I'll tell you that. But, you can do things. You can let your light shine. You're not condemning. You want to share the love of Jesus with others. And they watch you. People watch you. And they know there's a difference. So what should I do? What does God want me to do? This is an important verse for you to read. I want you to read 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. Open your Bible. Get home tonight. Write it down. Underline it. But it says, but you are a chosen race. Maybe you were the last to be chosen for that sports team or do this or some participation event in school. But you're chosen a race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for God's own possession. And there's a purpose. There's a goal. This is it. That you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. You got saved to do what? Come to church, have fun, play a game, eat a cupcake, get the warm spiritual fuzzies, jump up and down, have a great time in worship, and that's it? No. We are called to proclaim what God has done in our life. I saw on the back of the shirt, I'm not sure who's wearing it here, but it's listed the verse from Psalms 145, verse 13. There you go. That's it. Your kingdom, O Lord, is everlasting. And it goes on. This is written in Greek over a door in the church, now become a mosque, unfortunately, in Damascus, Syria. God's kingdom is everlasting. We need to proclaim that word. I've walked on Straight Street. I've seen where Paul was let down over the wall in the basket. I've seen Ananias' house and other places. I've walked where Elijah's been and Jesus and Paul and others have been. God wants to do a work. His kingdom is everlasting, and he proclaims it through you and I. He wants you and I to be his servants. I wish I could take you to Lebanon. They got great food there. You can go skiing in the mountains. You can go swim in the Mediterranean. I mean, it's a great place to be. Of course, there's sometimes that car bomb might go off or some difficulties here and there. You have to wait in line to get gas. One time I waited 12 hours and 50 minutes to get my gas in the car. So there's a few little things that might happen, but you can still be a witness there. And we go because God loves them and he wants his mercy to be extended to them as well. So we need to hear God's voice, listen to it, proclaim it. He's called you. He's given you hope. You've got a future. Whatever you think you're going to do, whatever you want to study, whatever you want to be in the future, God can use you. He wants you to proclaim. Thank you so much. And it's this is the nurse, right? All right. Good. Excellent. Thank you. I want you to know that God wants to use you. You are precious in his sight. Do I dare tell you how old I am?
Yes. Do it.
How old are you? 13. Okay. Anybody was 9 here at all? Just okay. God spoke to me when I was 9. Today, or now, this year, I had already had my birthday, but I'm 60. Yeah, I'm old. I shouldn't be in youth group, right? But you're young at heart. I still can do things. I mean, it's good. God wants to use you. And we need people to stand up and go forward and respond to the call of God. Listen to his voice. Proclaim what he has done for you. Don't be bashful. Let me tell you what happens. Often we're told here in the States, and I'm not saying it's wrong theology, but we're told to turn the other cheek. We're to love people. right? And that's true. But there in the Middle East, you need to stand for your faith. You need to be firm. You have a conviction, believe in it, you live it. I was studying Arabic at the University of Damascus, and there was a confrontation that took place. This man found out that I was from America. In his eyes, it is called the country of the great Satan. Why? Because we proclaim that we are Christian, and we got movies and MTV and videos and things where people are doing drugs, sleeping around, getting drunk, and, you know, wearing crosses, and that's a Christian. So he started out, he said, you come from the country of the great Satan. He started insulting America. Okay, well, turn the cheek, right? And then he starts insulting my family. Your family, they're nothing but a bunch of, and you know, in Arabic can be very expressive. I won't say those words here in church. You wouldn't understand them anyways. And then he said, and Jesus is not the Son of God, and you are a, and I said, whoa, hang on. And when we talk in the Middle East, here we have space in America, right? But he's in, you know, we're talking like this. That's a little uncomfortable, isn't it? Especially between guys. Now, you know, when you get spit in your mouth, it's like, yeah, I don't care. Where's the mouthwash? And I said, no, you can insult my country. You can even insult my family, but do not insult my faith in Jesus, who is my Savior. And when I stood toe-to-toe with him, we're nose-to-nose right there. And when he realized that I had a firm conviction, I believed, I lived what I believed, he backed down. You sow a seed in their life. And I'm here because God loves you. We're to love God with all of our heart, soul, and mind. And then we're to love our neighbor as ourselves. You're my neighbor. And we could sit down and drink some strong Arabic coffee. I didn't win him to Jesus, but he saw the difference. You need to stand for your faith. And coming back to America and things have changed here, I know you guys are growing up in a different way than I ever did. Please stand for your faith. Proclaim what God has done. Don't give up. You can do it. You can be a missionary right here on this doorstep of your own city, town, school, work, wherever you're at. God wants to use you. And if you're having trouble deciding what to do or what is God telling me, I want to refer you back to an Old Testament prophet, Isaiah. Isaiah and Isaiah chapter 6. It says, in the year Uzziah died, the king died, it passed away. What's going to happen? What's going to take place in this country? There's no leadership. Will I have a job tomorrow? Where are we going? We're going to be taken over. We're going to be, and all this stuff is happening. And when we look at the horizontal around us, we can get worried. Do you know what's happening? And we get caught up in the events of the world. But we need to have our eyes not horizontal, but vertical. And we look to God. We look to heaven. We see our Savior. And when Isaiah did that, he said, in the year that died, there's troubles going on. I saw the Lord high and lifted up. The seraphim, the angels were there crying out, holy, holy is the Lord. And then he says, woe me, I'm a man of unclean lips. I come from a people of unclean lips. Any of you seen the movie The Big Fat Greek Wedding? Maybe not. That's an older movie. And yeah. Well, my brother-in-law, when I was, you know, that veteran missionary I was working with, I started learning a few Arabic words, and he told me some words that I probably shouldn't have known. And he's a missionary. Okay, go figure. But he... But we need to realize we're people of unclean lips. We're not perfect. We need God's grace in our life. And so Isaiah's there and saying, woe is me. I'm bad. It's my bad. You know, I'm not good. And an angel took a coal from the altar and touched him, purified him, cleansed him. That fire from God that came. And then he hears God speak. And when we're there in a time, you've done worship here tonight and just sharing very briefly, but He's there in the presence of God, and he hears God's voice, and God says, who will go for us? And Isaiah responds saying, I will go. Send me. We're going to go back to Lebanon. We're going to continue work there, but in the near future, I don't know how much longer we'll do, but we'll retire. Who's going to come? Who's going to carry on? Who's going to reach here in the Alex area and or this county or in the state or wherever? We need people who hear the voice of God. God wants to use you. He wants to flow through you. And we need people. We need those for God to raise up mighty warriors for his glory. And we do it by sharing the love of Jesus with those that are around about us. One of the things that we've done is spend time with people, relationship there. And let me tell you a story of when they know who you are, if you truly love them or not. They can tell that if you talk about the love of God, if you have it or not. And people can tell if you're real or if you're a fraud, even here in the States, I know. But there's a man that was witnessed to, and if he was given a Bible to read, and he began to read the Bible, and he was going to use it so he could debate Christians and find the errors in the Bible, the Word of God. And as he began reading the Bible, he started having dreams and visions. This man would appear to him and would speak to him words. And he reads the Bible, and he said that in the dream, and he's finding it in God's Word. And then it arrived to the place in the New Testament. He started in Genesis, is reading through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus. How many like Numbers? Do you like the book? Have you ever read? I mean, Leviticus? So he gets to the New Testament. He's reading it through. He can't put the Bible down. He's just hungry. And he gets to John. And in one of the dreams, about the eighth dream that he had, he realizes what he heard in the dream came from Jesus. John 14:6. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father but through me." And there, witnessed to, prayed to accept Christ into his heart. We baptized him in water outside of his context, because when you become a baptized Christian, some of the Muslim families, it's their duty to kill you because you become an apostate. You've turned your back on Islam. So we did that privately in another area and brought him back, but he's witnessing. He heard the voice of God, and today he's become a minister and reaching out to others. I've been in his area. I won't tell you where or what place, but God is working, and he uses us when we hear his voice and say, "Yes, Lord, use me. I'm here." So if I can just challenge you tonight to be open for what God has for you to do. Don't think you're too young. He uses David. And, you know, we want the Goliath-killing kind of ministry, right? But God's preparing you even now. Because when you're watching the sheep, as he did as a shepherd boy, he killed the bear, he killed the lion, he took the lamb out of their mouth. He wants to do that for you now. Miracles just don't happen on the mission field. They happen in your life now as you give and you open your life to God. So I'm excited that you are here tonight. I am thankful that there are those that are considering what God wants them to do and others preparing for it. And to use a kind of a farmer little saying, the time you take to sharpen your tools is never wasted. You know, we need to prepare. That's part of our calling. That's part of our work. Back when I grew up, you know, it was in the 60s and people were, "Jesus is coming. Are you ready? Jesus is coming." I thought I'd never get to the mission field. He's going to come. I won't be able to do anything for him. But now, you know, 60 years later, I've been able to do something. And it took time. I had to prepare. I had to study. I had to learn some theology and learn how another language or two. And we use Arabic, French, English. We speak some other, but this is what we use in the Middle East. And God is good. He's building his church all over in places that you never even think of or hear about. But I just want to encourage you, God's voice, listen to it, hear it, let God use you, respond to him. I can't convince you, I can't call you, but God can use you, God can speak to you. Just say, "Lord, speak, here am I, speak to me." You are salt and light. In my graduating class where I grew up, we were 72 people. And there are two of us that were Christians in the class. But I guarantee you, every one of them knew what I believed in sharing the love of Jesus with them. You can do that as well. Let God use you. Is that all right? Can you do that? I want God to speak to you, not just tonight, but during this week in this church, becoming a servant, helping out at the wherever here, as your pastor mentioned. This is part of ministry. God can use you. And he's not looking at how big you are, how well you can sing, or you can do this or play that. Or he knows your heart. And if you're available, he will use you. Amen. I just want to say thank you for listening to an old guy. But God is faithful. I can stand here and say that God is faithful. Amen. Can I pray with you? I'm going to give it back. Pastor's coming. Is that all right? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this group of people that have come here to seek your face tonight. I ask that your voice would be made known, that you would speak to them in their heart, their mind, through your word, by your spirit, and even through the body of Christ, others here in this church. Lord Jesus, open up their ears that they might hear your voice, that they might discern what you want them to do. Lord, fill them to overflowing. Let there be rivers of living water. May they be salt and light. May their light shine even brighter after tonight as they've heard what you want them to do. Lord, let them be your servants for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. David, thank you so much for what you shared. If you guys realize, a lot of what he shared tonight is what we've been talking about over the last couple of months. And we haven't, like, he and I didn't talk about message prep. I told him, whatever God puts on your heart, you share that, right? And so I hope that you guys were listening. I hope that you heard what he said and how we listen to God, how God speaks to us. He gave you three ways. Who knows what they were? What are the three ways that God speaks? Through his word? Prayer? Not through a spirit. Well, through a spirit, through prayer. But what was the other one? Through the what?
Who's around you?
Your church, right? Very good. All right. So do you guys have any questions for David? Even if it's someone online, I don't know if anybody's still watching the stream or not, but if there's anyone, if you have any questions, I'll have these guys just shout them at me and we'll ask them of David. Is that okay? Can we do a Q&A? Do you guys have any questions for David? I'll have him come back up and I'll grab a microphone so you can actually ask the question directly to him.
I went on short-term trips. I went to Haiti. I was in Africa. But when I went full-time, I started when I was 24, full-time career. Anyone else? Question? Yes.
Anyone?
What was the city that you went to for, like, a long time?
Andrea has all the questions.
I was in West Africa at the time. I went to the city of Dalawa, Ivory Coast, Côte d'Ivoire. And I started a church two blocks from the largest mosque in the city.
Wow. Anybody else?
And no, I haven't eaten a dog, at least that I'm aware of. Okay, just a second.
Let's give someone else a chance to ask a question. Anybody else? We're good.
Glad you asked. Our church, we have, I pastor a couple of churches in Lebanon. We've started, we bought land, built a church in the northern city of Tripoli, Lebanon. Million plus people in that area. One of the men in our church, became sick, was brought to the hospital, and he died in the hospital. And God raised him from the dead. Wow. And today he's an elder in our church.
Wow. So, and
well, I mean, everybody knew. The whole hospital, the whole city knows. He's got a great testimony of God's grace and miracle-working power. Dead, but brought back to life.
Andrea?
Have you ever gone to China?
Yes, I have been to China.
Did you eat a horse?
You asked the weird girl. Okay. We're not answering that question. You don't have to answer that question, sir.
Let's just say I've eaten a variety of animals. I mean, I grew up in the country. And you learn to pray before you eat. It isn't just, Lord, bless this food, bless it, amen. You know, you intercede sometimes.
Have you ever touched a Chinese cat?
I will say yes. I've eaten. Yeah, and yeah. Sorry. I mean,
the cat's out of the bag now.
Uh-oh. Cat's out of the bag. Was in the stomach, too. I mean.
All right. Any other questions related to missionary work?
Listen, it's not all hard. Missions is fun. You can laugh. You can have fun. Yes. People joke. Even with them, you can. It's how you live. Yes.
Hold on, before you answer that. So the question was, how did you know that you heard God's voice before you were called? I just want to make, I meant to say that for everybody else listening at home, but great question.
I want you to know that your call, everyone's call is different than another. You have a Moses kind of burning bush experience of some. Others have a Jeremiah, Isaiah experience. I was at a prayer meeting. God spoke to me, audible or silent voice, but I knew he spoke to me. And he also gave me a vision, a dream of doing certain things in ministry. I've done many of those things today, yet some I have not yet done. But God spoke to me clearly, and then it was testified. Others sensed that, and the pastor at that time confirmed that call. I was at camp, and others confirmed it, the body. God spoke to me by his spirit and through his word. So that's why I say these things. But he spoke very clearly at 9. I knew it was him. I knew his voice, and he showed me what I was to do.
Anything else? Because I'm about to wrap this thing up, people. All right, so here's what I want to do, guys. David, when do you head back to Lebanon?
We are halfway through our itineration. We'll go back in October.
Go back in October. Okay, so here's what I want to do. Students, I want you to come forward. We are going to pray for David and his family tonight. We're also going to pray for their time here in the States as they itinerate. We want to make sure that we cover him and his family and the mission field that he will be going back into. If you feel comfortable laying a hand on his shoulder or extending a hand, then I want you to do that. But I'm going to pray. And what I want to do is I want to give you guys an opportunity. If God speaks something to you that you want to share with David tonight, feel free to share that. We're not going to be here very long. And don't worry if it gets where there's awkward silence, I will fill in the silence and I will say amen. You got it? So I'll start and then I'll let you guys have an opportunity to pray for him. So Heavenly Father, we thank you for David. We thank you for his ministry. God, we thank you that you sent him. We thank you that you called him and his family to Lebanon to minister to a people who need to know you. Father, we thank you for the relationships that have been built where he's been able to be Jesus to people, even if they don't say yes to Jesus. God, the importance of that very moment where people can see the grace, the mercy, the friendship that Jesus extended to people, whether they loved him or did or denied him. God, that is so important for us to know. And so, God, I pray that you would continue to bless. God, that you would continue to give him more experience in which he can share with people. God, I thank you for the opportunities that I'm sure he's had to share what's in the Bible with the people right in the region where some of those things have happened. And so, God, Will you continue to fill him, continue to give him energy, continue to put strength in his body to continue to fly back overseas, God, and stay in the mission field in Jesus' name. So, Lord, we're just grateful that we had an opportunity to hear from him. God, we thank you that you're speaking even now to these students. God, I pray that you would, Lord, that you would reveal to them what their purpose is, what you're calling them to do. And God, that we would all be a light in dark places, that we would, God, that we would model Christ-like behavior in every single circumstance that we find ourselves, whether it be at home, at school, at work. God, whether it be with our friends or parents or a stranger in the grocery store,
God, let us be a shining example of who Jesus is. And we pray all of these things in the mighty and precious name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Hey, I'm so glad that you students came. Thank you for praying with us. For those of you that are watching online, I'm grateful that you were here. We're going to sign off for tonight. We'll be back here next week, 6:30. So bring a friend, and we'll see you next week. Thanks.